I thank God. class this morning. Christians, we're not supposed to have a good time. Do not have a good time this morning. Not in here, not out there. Do not have a good time. Sit around and just sit in the doldrums and just, you know, don't enjoy life.
Through it all, through it all. Congregation spokesperson isn't here this morning. She'll be here tonight. But God bless her. She's been good with words and sentences and making up stories since she was 2 years old. Really. She would sit in the back seat of the car. As just a little toddler, she'd start telling a story, made up completely, but you wouldn't know it. She never hesitated, never paused at the end of a line. And I thought sometimes she was telling a true story and she was just making it up. She's always been good at speech and good with her words, so miss her this morning. But on the serious side, I think I saw something. There's a lot of firsts taking place in my life, like let's say in the past year, maybe year and a half, a lot of firsts. And I had another first when Brother Mark Shell was here. We know how bad his voice was. It's the worst I've heard any preacher step into the pulpit. And when I knew, when he called me on his way up and had his wife to talk for him in the car, I thought, boy, how are you going to preach tonight? Not only did he preach with that rusty, terrible voice, we saw what kind of a man he was. He preached that way for, what, an hour and a quarter Saturday night? At least an hour and a quarter on Sunday morning. He preached till his voice wouldn't go any further. But I thought he'll preach 15 or 20 minutes like I probably would in that situation and just bring a short sermonette. But that's not Mark for you. He preached and did he bless our hearts abundantly. He just blessed our hearts abundantly. We're going to hear some testimonies. But first, Sean Milton is going to race up here real fast. And because he hasn't preached for at least 2 weeks, the lion's going to come out of him. We sing some choruses about lions. Jesus being the lion of the tribe of Judah. But we've got a lion here. So, Sean, you're supposed to preach like a lion this morning. God bless him and anoint and bless our hearts this morning.
Good morning. Good morning. I will do so. Richard just gave me a charge, so that means it's time to get busy. Got to get down to work. Roll up our sleeves and start. You know, the gospel's always serious. I was thinking about that, you know, as we were reflecting there from Sunday school too, that, you know, there are so many Even that one Bible verse that talks about, there's so many voices in the world, and none of them are not without significance. It's just, my sheep know my voice. And there's this anticipation that when we're here with God and having God in us and working through us, that I believe it's when it makes life more complete. I just can't, you know, like Rich, I love when you make the comments, been too far to turn back now. Too far down this road with God, too many blessings, too many times he's saved me, helped me. He never fails, is what the Bible says. And those that would be critical, have you had that? I've had so many down through the years. This is my little pre-sermon at Richard. I don't need to get into something like that. But so many down through the years that I believe looked, we'll even say critically, down on me like so many say. I mean, that is one of the criticisms. If you ever followed like Marx and some of these people that would come up with their whole new social constructs, many of them have referred to religion as the opiate of the masses. That's a Marx statement. And what do they mean? He thought it was a fake thing to soothe and satisfy and salve people. And I just think to myself, what a fool. For one, that he went out to eternity with that mindset, but for two, to not have benefited from God in his life closer than a brother. How do you do that? Like those that have been critical of me, it makes me inwardly, I don't want to say laugh, maybe. Like, you're being critical and you think I don't have it figured out, and I look at you like the fool says in his heart, there is no God. It's the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. That could have been pre-sermon number one. Richard, you're rubbing off on me. I like doing that too. I don't mean to do that, but God's good. Any time that we spend time with him studying, it's one of my favorite things is not just being up here. You think preaching is up here delivering a message and trying to, and I love not just bringing the word for all of you, but for eons to come, because we're capturing this and it's going out live and other, but I take it so, I take the weight of the responsibility so seriously, and it's some of the most joyous times in my life when I'm preparing for these. Richard, I mean, you've done that so many times over the years. Sean's done it too, others, that it's one of my greatest joys when I'm just sitting all by myself, either having a tearful moment or of happiness or moments of joy, and it's just me and God working out the next message. I just love it, and God's good. And so, speaking of talking to God, it's been a while. We've had so much busyness going on. I feel like, you know, it's been since I've been up here to be able to bring a word. So I'm still stuck on little kids making their prayers to God or talking about their relationships. These are kind of some cute ones. I got a couple of funny things. Let's see. Attending a wedding for the first time, a little girl whispers to her mother. We got weddings in the air this year, so I thought this was cute. She whispers to her mother, "Why is the lady dressed in white?" "Because white's the color of happiness, and today is the happiest day of her life." The child sits there and puzzles and says, "So why is the guy wearing black?" Sometimes they wear blue, right? So, you know, it's all good. A Sunday school teacher was asking her class, "What was Jesus' mother's name?" One little child blurts out, "Mary." And then the teacher asks, "Who knows what Jesus' father's name was?" A little boy reaches up and says, "Verge." Verge, the confused, I can't finish the joke because I like this one so much. Confused, the teacher asks, "Where'd you get that?" His kid says, "Well, you know, they're always talking about Verge and Mary." I just love it. This, I know I've said this before, but we'll take it back to Richard. A 3-year-old Reese was praying, "Our Father, who does art in heaven, Harold is his name, amen." I can't help that one. That one's a good. And then, since I brought up the Ten Commandments, here, this is a really cute one. Sunday school class, studying the Ten Commandments. They were discussing the last one. If you know, those covet ones, those are tough ones, right? Even as a kid, I remember. The teacher asked if anyone could tell what it was. Little Susie raised her hand and stood tall and quoted, "Thou shalt not take the covers off your neighbor's wife." there's some truth there. I don't know. I mean, just, you know, it's the whole thing. So anyway, I can't help it. There's, you know, I got a lot of them. Sorry. After christening of his baby brother in church, Jason sobbed all the way back in the back seat of the car. His father asked him 3 times what was wrong. Finally, the boy replied, "That preacher said he wanted us brought up in a Christian home, and I wanted to stay with you guys." Woo! Let's pray. No, that's good. God's good in everything. And I could take an amen corner this morning, Ash. That would be great. So, this morning, the message God laid on my heart, it's been several weeks ago now. Like I said, it's kind of interesting when you, but Richard, you've made this comment too. The word doesn't spoil. It goes back thousands of years. It's continuing. His word does not return void. Another great verse, right? It always accomplishes what it's set out to do. But I want to talk to you this morning about how doubt is destroying you. So, you know, there's so many different ways to look into the window of the scripture. The Bible talks about it being a mirror, almost like a reflection. It kind of reflects back to us a bit of what we see. You know, sometimes we look in the mirror and we're like, oh, got things to work on. Holly had me get that. Yes, he never bothered me a bit. Holly had me get one of those close-up mirrors that she thought would be neat at one of her birthdays, and we got that on the wall, and the girls like it because you come over and it's got a magnifying lens in it. But you look in that, and it's like you can look in the regular mirror and be like, okay, ready for the day. And you get in the magnifying mirror, and you're like, that's on my skin? Right? It shows something. And in a way, the Bible is a bit of a mirror reflecting. And it's, you think, man, Sean, that's a downer. Like, no, actually, it's a freeing thing. How many want to walk out of the house with that green thing between your teeth? Like, oh, good thing I looked in the mirror and I checked myself to recognize that something was out of sorts. Something was not right. And the Bible, I think that's where people have taken it wrong. They look at that Bible like a bunch of do's and don'ts. I don't need that, Sean. No more of that in my life. Instead of looking at this, I know we taught on that a few months ago, talking about the Bible being freedom. Like freedom with a bunch of do's and don'ts. I don't view that as do's and don'ts. Richard said this morning, was talking about, I can do as much of the wrong thing as I want to do, but I don't do it. Why? Because I know those pathways that lead to destruction. And in a way, I want to focus on this topic of doubt this morning for the same framework, if you want to call it that. Because doubt, I've got several things here. Doubt is a thief. Doubt is the kind of thing that's going to rob from you. How many of you would knowingly, a guy's walking up that hasn't even pulled out his weapon, and you're like, here, hand over your wallet, and just hand over to the thief, like, they don't even have to try. Thanks. Like, you're going to steal from me, so I just might as well let you steal. Just keep stealing. And I love that verse that says, let him who steals steal no more. Don't let him take from us easily. Don't let the enemy easily, readily steal from you. It's kind of like go on vacation and put a big poster in the front yard that says, I'm gone, door's unlocked, help yourself. Who would do that? That sounds so silly. But in our lives, we allow the enemy to just freely steal from us. And doubt is one of those areas. And it takes our hopes, it takes our dreams, turns them into fear, which becomes so paralyzing to our lives. So this is kind of the rhetorical question I'm asking through this. What happened if you would stop doubting? What if you looked doubt right in the face and crushed it? You ever say, we're going to crush this? Well, you think, is it, Sean, you're making it very simplistically. But part of you inwardly has to have that person rise up that says, why am I sitting here till I die? Like the lepers did at the gate. Why am I sitting here putting up with this? Why am I allowing my doubts to paralyze me? And many times fear feels like that. I remember learning, how many of you had taken first aid training, right? You had to take, and I remember that was one of the most interesting thing, the whole, stop, call, care, you know, the different acronyms you had to learn for stuff. But one of the things that I thought was most interesting in those first aid trainings was that if you're the one kind of taking the lead, that you, it isn't good enough to say, someone call 911. Those of you been in, you know that, they don't tell you that, do they? What do they tell you? You call 911. You go get a first aid kit. You have to put people personally, you have to make them personally responsible because people become paralyzed in moments of, and they talk about this, and that's why somebody that is willing to take the lead has to literally take the lead. And you think, Sean, I'm not much of a leader in my life. That's just never been my strong suit. Well, in our Christian walk, when we're commanded to work out our salvation with fear and trembling, that means you're not a follower. You are an active leader in your life. And if doubt has been the kind of thing that has caused paralysis in parts of your life, then it's time to take action. It's time to, like I use that term, crush it. Crush it. He's under my feet. We like singing that song, right? And we can sing that, we can say that, but that's just words until we put that to action. And as a like construct, I think about this sanctuary so many years ago when we had this built. This sanctuary, you think, here it is. Well, you can't speak this sanctuary into existence, but technically we did. It was Richard's vision, and sitting in the other part thinking, one of these days it would be nice to have a sanctuary out here, and we set up chairs, like how many could we fit? How big would it be? And you think, we spoke it into existence, our words just leapt out, and here's chairs and walls and studs and drywall. Well, took a little action, didn't it? Took a little effort. It took a little legs with our faith-inspired effort. And to the same point, kind of like Paul's admonishment to us to, you know, lay aside the sin and the weight that's easily besetting us. What was Paul saying? He was giving us a bit of a call to action. There's got to be something in you that says, no more doubting. I don't want to doubt. And so, yes, and I got some great verses to want to go along with this. So let me move along here as we can. But the point is, that passion within us will translate if we can stay steadfast in this. And, you know, I was making reference to so many voices, right? I had written down, I love that song, because I've been really following Casting Crowns a lot lately. But I love that song they written so many years ago called Voice of Truth. It tells me a different story. It tells me to not be afraid, right? Good wordsmithing in that song. And what does that mean? You know, I've been considering this too. How many know, and especially at night, that's when we hear those small voices of doubt and despair and frustration, and it almost feels like it's just constant nagging or whispering in my ear of where I don't measure up, or where I'm failing, or that's never going to happen. And there has to come some recognition that if those are coming from, if they're coming from you, or they're coming from the enemy, there's got to be a recognition to say, wait a second, are those real? Are they real? Is that truthful, what I'm hearing in my head? Can you lie to yourself? Can our own, you know, negative experiences with other so paint a picture for us that we get stuck in a loop? Of course they can. Any of us that have known what it's like to struggle through anxiety or even worry and doubt, which is my focus this morning, it comes from those voices that continue, that just, you keep listening. And the point is, we have to acknowledge, no more. I don't want to hear the voice. I want a voice of truth. I want something different. No. I know I'm hearing those voices of doubt, but I want a different paradigm for myself. I want something better. And here's what was interesting. People that, we can doubt ourselves in so many areas. I kind of had a bunch of examples I was just looking up. I like this. Your doubts are killing more dreams than failure ever will. Let me say that again. Your doubts are killing more dreams within you than failure, actual failure, ever will. Meaning, I would rather you try and fail than fail here before anything ever happens. And that, you know, because they talk about like starting a business. People, there's lots of statistics that 70% of new business startups fail. And that, so many people never try because they hear that statistic and think, what's the point? But who are you? Who am I? I love that song. That the Lord of all the earth would care to know mine, know my name, care to know my worth. Who am I? I'm maybe not much in my own strength, but he and I together are formidable. You and he are formidable. Why do you doubt then? Why do you assume the worst, like it's never going to happen, like most people doubting, am I smart enough for this job or what I'm trying to accomplish? Am I good enough to make the decisions that are in front of me for my family or it could be work? Or am I solving my fitness goals? There's so many. I was thinking about New Year's coming up, and people tend to make fitness goals, and that's why health clubs get really busy at the beginning of the year, and then they fall off. And that's inner doubt that stops us from making it past January on those things. I had that as an example. But any goal you set for yourself, you think, well, I had this goal years ago to do X, but never happened. Like, why? Why did it die on the vine, so to speak? What is that? And, you know, I know one of my joking ones was, you know, whatever you put your mind to do, you can do it, right? In God. Well, I can also say, you know, I always had the desire to be in the NBA. Wait, you're not supposed to laugh there. He says, at 5'9", I could, right? That's a really good height to start into the NBA. Right, no. So I didn't. That wasn't an official dream. By the time I got cut from the basketball team in seventh grade, I had hung up my basketball shoes. I, you know, that wasn't in my pathway. But that wasn't the dream or desire within me. Being able to speak like this was. Here I am. What's your dream? And, you know, I know I've talked to young people in our lives, and many over the years that I've mentored, and I'll jokingly make the comment, what do you want to be when you grow up? And, you know, when you're little, you know, princess, you know, astronaut or whatever. But I ask adults my age that. What do you want to be when you grow up? I ask you this morning, what do you want to be when you grow up? When are you going to grow up? I don't know. It's kind of fuzzy. I jokingly, people in my family jokingly say, you know, act like a kid. I think you're as old as you want to be. I stopped at about 22. And I'm like, Holly, I can still be 22. And she's like, Sean, we don't look 22. She's not in here. Like, I don't know. Depends on how I see myself. But the point is, what do I envision for me? What do I envision for my future? And if you can jokingly say, what do you want to be when you grow up? I don't care if you retired from 30, 40 years in a career. What are you doing tomorrow? What are you doing today? Because you are given life and breath, and there's something. Don't let your dreams die, and don't let doubt destroy. It's just a thief. It's a thief, any other thing. You ever been in a crowd, and all of a sudden us guys will check your pocket, make sure your wallet's there, you ladies put your purse over, and you know, I got my purse. Why do you do that? You're not easily letting the thief take what you've got. Of course you're not. But why do we do it in the natural? Why do we let our dreams die? Why do we let him rob from us? Like, put the sign in the front yard and say, enemy, I'm not going to make it. My dreams are never going to get through. So you might as well just bring the, beep, beep, pull the truck up in the driveway and unload. Oh, I got a good TV in the other room. Oh, you're missing my jewelry's in my little box on my dresser. Get that too. And I got money in the little stash, my little shoebox in the closet. Don't forget that. We can all be laughing. I see smiles. And the point is, why do we let the enemy do that to us? Or why do we let that voice in our own head from our own jaded experiences rob from us instead of listening to his voice, the voice of truth that says, I think his word says, does his word say, I do it like Mark. His word says I can do a couple things through Christ who strengthens me. Mark Shell, right? Shout out to Mark. Yeah. Does that what it says? Nope. That's not what it says. I can do all. There's a bit of a connotation. What does that mean? Can I be an NBA star? That's not my point. My point is I don't need to be the NBA star when I'm doing what God set me out to do. I'm accomplishing great things through him who sent me. I'm an instrument of righteousness for his name's sake, and being able to play a beautiful melody in music through my life to touch people in a way that I never thought was possible. He gets all the credit and the glory. but I'm living that life, pretty good deal. How's that? So I had some notes here on even secular studies of this, people talking about the power of self-doubt. And this isn't even having a Christian basis. Psychologists, other. I thought this was so interesting. I spent some time. They did this one survey they did of people. 70% of respondents admitting to lacking confidence in work, family, life, and other. Most people that they would quiz were like, yeah, I just don't have what I need. I don't have what it takes. I could never do that job. And what's the difference between you and someone else? Being where you are in Christ, being able to set yourself apart. It's kind of why when God says, I set you apart, when you became a Christian, he set you apart for something different, something great. And I, you know, back to my original little sermonette, talking about why would I serve God? I've always thought I like being a part of something that's doing something big, that's doing something great. We can't get any bigger than the God of the universe that wants to be involved in my life and helping me in my pathways and my dreams and realizing my goals and vision. He wants me to prosper in all things. If he cares enough to send his son for me, and you don't think he cares about the very doubts that we're struggling with at the core of who we are? And this is, I'm going to touch on this in another way too, because many times I think because of our doubts, we assume God doesn't, that we're boxing God out of our lives because of our doubts. We assume that somehow, since we're doubting, what would God want to do with me? I can't even get through to my family. God wouldn't want anything to do with me either. And that, watch that spiral right down the drain. Again, it's the same philosophy of thinking, enemy, just the front door's open, come rob me, whatever you want to take. It's all yours for the taking. I want you to have that mental image this week as you're thinking about this message. And my prayer always is that we would. I want you to, not just that I've spent the time and Sean gave a word. When I'm bringing something from God's word, I want it to touch your life. I want you to think about what it will take to eradicate doubt in your life. Like, can I do that, Sean? If he's concerned about bringing all things that pertain to life and godliness to my life, I think doubt's in the category. I think doubt's right in there that we want to try to get that out. And here's what was interesting when I was reading about some of these self-help secular versions. And I was listening to some of their excerpts. This is my favorite part. When you hear somebody that doesn't give God credit and they're giving advice, great. And as I'm looking at these, I was like, wait a second. I think I've seen these before. One of theirs was, if you're struggling with self-doubt and you want to overcome that, seek outside perspective. I think there's a verse that says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lead on to your own understanding. Don't listen to your own voice all the time. In all your ways, acknowledge him. Sarah's singing, I love it. And he'll direct your paths. Okay, good job, psychologists. I think that's in the Bible. Good one. One of the other things they said was, embrace an educational mindset. Don't always be the person that assumes you know everything and that you're just stuck listening to those doubtful voices and there's no hope. I think Paul told Timothy, study to show yourself approved and keep learning to gain what that truth, that knowledge. Take yourself from glories to glories through God because he's everything. Another one they said, remember how far you've come. Count your many blessings. Name them one by one, right? I love this. That there is, and again, there's so many great perspectives out there, but the Bible makes it very clear that doubt is simply something that diffuses. It's like a wet blanket for the Holy Spirit's fire within you. It's like throwing, you ever had that something? I put out a fire the other day, and you know, it's flaming and it's doing really good, and I had a bucket of water, and it's like you throw that on and pretty soon, whoof, just goes out. And I think we need the fire of the Holy Spirit within us working and empowering us to do something. And doubt is like a big bucket of water on God, what God's doing in your life. We need that. We need that. Somehow, that wasn't in my notes, but God's good. There's something in there that he has that. So now I thought I'd give you some perspective because, Sean, I'm struggling with doubts. Guess what? You're not alone. In this group and in the Bible, you're in good company. Jesus' disciples struggled with doubts. Walking, I mean, you think, wouldn't you be exempt if you're walking with the Son of God visibly? And there it is in glorious verse for all of us to see. The disciples walking with the Master were struggling with doubt after watching the miracles firsthand. If they struggle with it, of course we're going to struggle with it. And so here's just a couple examples. One of them being John the Baptist. And what I loved about this, I mean, his mom was a cousin of Mary, mother of Jesus. I mean, they were kin. So God selected him. God chose him out of the womb. He's a prophet. He was a man of God. He had great faith. He baptized Jesus. You think, again, those of you that would struggle in this area and think, God, I don't know why I'm struggling with doubts and fears. I want to go the right direction, but if they struggled with it, everybody has the potential to struggle with this. The point is, there is a way past. So what happened with him? In Matthew 11, Jesus talked about John the Baptist, said, truly I say to you, among those born of women, there's arisen no one greater than John the Baptist. Jesus is making bold proclamations about John. And yet, John gets to this point when he's in prison and he's struggling like all of us do. And he says this, when John heard the deeds that he sent word to by his disciples and said to him, are you the one to come or should we look for another? Where did John go mentally to be from? I'm baptizing Jesus. Behold, here's the dove, the Son of God. And then he's like, are you the one? He was questioning, completely questioning, are you the one? John the Baptist. I mean, I take great instruction from this to say, I'm not alone in this struggle. You're not alone in this struggle. And it was almost like he reeked of that self-debasing experience that many of us go through. He was like, are you really him? Did I mess this up? I've been waiting. Anybody like waiting for anything? Waiting on God, whatever. But I love Jesus' comment. And this is something that I think everybody should recognize. When he gave word back to the disciples and said, he told them, he first showed them, look what I'm doing, count your many blessings, and acknowledge to him what good that I have been doing. He responded like this. Let's see. I have it down here. Go and tell John what you hear and see, all the blessings, all the healings, all those things. Blind receive sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up. Poor have the good news preached to them. He pointed them back to the good God had been doing the whole time. He'd never stopped. Just because we can get stuck in a rut. You ever been stuck in a mud rut or a snow rut or, you know, whatever, and you're stuck. And then you're meant to travel, and that vehicle is going nowhere. What's it take? Somebody's got to pop us out of there. We need a friendly tow, so to speak. And the word is an anchor for your soul. It's the one thing to help us get through this kind of stuff. But here's what I want to note, and I think this is so great about Jesus himself. What he didn't do in response to John. Pay attention. What didn't Jesus do? He didn't come out harsh and say, what a fool. He didn't have condemnation for John for his doubts. And I think somebody needs to hear that in our lives. I think many times we feel ineffective with God because we doubt. And God's not shaken off the throne because you doubt. Somebody needs to hear that. God doesn't relinquish his authority because of your doubts. If anything, he's emboldened to continue to be there for you, to show you, like Jesus did, pay attention. The blind are made to see, the poor are preached to, the lame are made to walk. God's continuing to work all around you. Pay attention and notice the good that continues to happen through God. I'm not condemning you. I'm not here to pass judgment. I'm just here to show you I've never left you, nor will I forsake you. I'll be there with you, what's he say, till the end of the age. I'm not leaving. I'm not leaving. And probably my theme scripture this morning, this is the one I really wanted to go to. And it's in Mark 9 and 24. It is one of the most honest prayers in the Bible for any one of us that are struggling. And if you haven't read this, this is such a good one. You know, I might just, let's just go there real quick. Mark 9 and 24. It's too good to not, I don't want to just read the notes on it. I want to read it. That's all right. Too good a verse to not want to just pick it out and do it distinctly. Okay, here we go. So, okay, we're going to back up. So they were talking about the Hanson said, in 19, we're talking about this one that's been caught and the boy that's being healed. And so, you know, in 19, he answered, you know, how long is everybody going to be with me? Bring this boy to me. They brought him in to him. Immediately he saw the spirit convulsed him. He fell to the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked the father, how long has this been happening to the dad? How long has your boy been sick? And he said, from childhood. I've been dealing with doubt and frustration since my son was a child, and it's wearing on me as a dad. That's what we're not hearing, and that's what he's saying. Often he's throwing himself in the fire, in the water, and he says, with that bit of faith, but yet tinged with his own frustration, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said to them, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And I love the cry of this father. I love it. Immediately, the father of the child cried out, said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. The honest cry of a father that's at his wit's end and frustrated. And many of us have been there in life so many times. Like, God, I believe. I don't even want to say I don't believe. I've been struggling for so long. I don't know the pathway forward. But I trust you. There's part of me that knows you're the right way. You are the way. I know it instinctively, and yet I still hear those voices, and they spin me around and take me the wrong direction. And I love the honesty, because immediately the father of the child, after saying that, when Jesus saw what happened, he rebuked the unclean spirit. Get out. And you know the rest of that verse. So, What a honest cry from a honest heart, that we go through things and we deal with those things, and yet we can always find a path forward if we're trusting God in the midst of our difficult time. So I had a few quotes. I like at times to look up, because there's people all around us that all of us struggle with these things. You're not unique. The Bible says things that affect us, afflict us, are common to man. The trials you and I experience, you're not unique to what you're going through. Someone's been through it. Someone's whipped it with God's help. So there's hope. That's what's so great. Here, a quote, some of these are cute, but Benjamin Franklin said, when in doubt, don't. Hey, this William Blake said, if the sun and moon should ever doubt, they'd immediately go out. Like, they don't have a choice. Like, okay, that's pretty. But I love the word picture there. Michael Strahan said this, we're our own worst enemy. You doubt yourself more than anybody else ever will. If you can get past that, you can be successful. I like that. I really like that a lot. How many times are you your own worst enemy? Worse than anybody else. I like Christopher Reeve, former Superman. He said this, a hero is someone who, in spite of weakness, doubt, or not knowing the answers, goes ahead and overcomes anyway. I like that a lot. That was a good one. This was Jose Rizal. I don't know him. To doubt God is to doubt one's own conscience, and in consequence, it would be to doubt everything. And then, what is life for? I love that. Kind of back to my initial premise. I know that God is everything to me. I wouldn't try this life without him. I think that would be a fool's errand. But he is good. Steven Tyler, if you know him, he said, maybe life is random, but I doubt it. That was kind of cute. And Marge Piercy, which I didn't know that, this person, but never doubt that you can change history. You already have. Never doubt that you can change history. I think that's a really cute, you know, I've been struck by, I get stuck on, like, sci-fi movies are one of my faves, and kind of a movie buff, right? And, you know, if you watch any sci-fi movie, they always wrestle with, what if you change the timeline and it changed the future? Are you going to disappear? You know, and what if I set something different in motion? And then I think the instruction I take from watching scenes like that is, you are not, kind of like the movie Forrest Gump, where he talks about the feather floating around. Is life just a box of chocolates and it's, you're left to chance? Or is God orchestrating something beautiful through our life? Even when we doubt, even when you doubt, God can show you a better way by you counting his many blessings and seeing life is not accidental. You didn't accidentally fall into where you are. You didn't accidentally fall into that situation at work that's difficult, but yet you're a light and an example in a dark place. You didn't fall accidentally into the family you fell into, Sean. There's some accidents in my family. Well, whatever that is, whatever, you're there, appointed for a time and purpose. And Ecclesiastes talks about there's a time and a season for everything under heaven. And if I'm living in such a time as now, you weren't born, back to my time traveler analogy, you're not going back to whatever, 1800s or forward to something else. You were born for such a time as this. And it means right now, right here, you were not meant to doubt. You were meant to believe and hope for all things because it's God, it's Christ who gives you strength. It's he who works through us and in us. And if I had to give you another example, which is a great one, is I had some examples from King David, who's one of the best ones in this. You think, oh, King David, slay Goliath. Yeah, but you know what else David said? David said this in Psalm 42 and 5. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why are you disturbed within me? David, lament of the heart, his own frustrations. It was the same kind of, I believe, help my unbelief. Because he says this next. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. In the midst of his own doubt and discouragement, David could still, why do you think David was listed as a guy after God's own heart? Because of that. Because no matter how much he doubted, he put himself just as passionately back into his service of God, his loving of God and seeking of God in the midst of difficult times. Yeah, because here's another one that he did, Psalm 13. If you've ever, I know I've made this acknowledgement before, but it's one of, if you're really struggling, this is my own bit of advice if I had to give you some. I'm not kidding. And if you don't know this, did you know that when you take your Bible and cut it, put your fingers in and stick it right in the middle, you usually end up in Psalms, unless you got weird concordances or something. Usually you end up right in Psalms if you cut your Bible right in half because it's so big, 150 chapters, right? I am not kidding. My viewpoint is if you're struggling, go to the Psalms and just start reading anywhere. I don't even care where. But you'll come across things like David in Psalm 13. How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? Forget me? Slew Goliath? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts? One day after day, have sorrow in my heart. How long will my enemy triumph over me? You ever struggled in the middle of the night? David did too. David did too, but he's also the guy that said, put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. You want an antidote to those downcast, doubt-filled nights of sleeplessness? Praise the Lord. Is it that simple, Sean? Works for me. I'm just giving you my own advice. Those moments when you're struggling and you think, I can't see up, I'm too far down, put yourself in a perspective of praising him. The one, find that connectivity with that one who made your very existence, put you on the pathway toward greater and better things. So, man, I had a lot of examples I could do. All right, so what I want to end with here then, if I think, because there's some Easter doubts. Thomas was another favorite character. And I when I look at doubting Thomas, we call him. But if you didn't know this, Thomas, if you follow, there's all these really good books on the disciples after Jesus passed and the works they did. They're not really recorded in the Bible per se. Thomas went on, they said he went to India and several places and ministered to multitudes. Doubting Thomas became an amazing evangelist for God. How'd you like to have that nickname forever? But he's the one that was doing great and mighty things. Why? He may have started in a point of, I won't believe in that he's risen from the grave until I want to see it for myself. You ever been that kind of person, been in that perspective? I need to see it, God. I need some evidence. The doubts are too much. And it was Jesus came right to him and was like, check him out. Now how you doing, Thomas? Where's your faith meter now? Where are you? He's also the one that asked Jesus still. It's one of my favorite verses in the Bible. And I think it's one of my favorites because it's my own heart's cry. That part of me that wants to know my own pathway. Anybody else a perpetual struggler that wants to know what's in front of me? I don't like uncertainty, God. This is Sean. This isn't just preaching. I don't like uncertainty. I like to know the pathway in front of me. I would have been like totally like Thomas. You're talking about going away. How are we going to know the way? And Jesus, I just picture him being so, so loving with Thomas. He's like, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way. You're looking for a map. There's no map needed. I'm the map. It's you're going to find it in me, hid in Christ. That's how you're going to find it. You want to get past the clouds of doubt so that we have a ray of sunshine breaking through. You ever seen that? Like this morning, it was beautiful. I told Holly, I was like, right the moment, the sun was coming up, there's a little bit of clouds off in the east. The moment that sun popped through, I said, oh, Lexi's bedroom. I said, it looked like he turned a light on in there because it just... In our lives, we need that ray of sunshine to break through and make doubt go scurrying for the corners. We do. You ever done that? Make the little critters go scurrying for the corners because you turn the lights on. We've illuminated God's goodness in our lives. We've shown what he can do, that counting our blessings, that we know he is good. And I'm going to end with this. This is my ending verse. Matthew 7:7-8. Ask, it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock, it shall be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. To the one who knocks, it will be opened. If you're struggling with doubt, you've got to knock on the door. You can't sit there and allow the voices to keep holding you in the dark room. It's time to come out into the light. Expose that. Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. That's the start. And then walk into his glorious light. Lord, I just thank you for your goodness this morning. You're a good God. Lord, these are real things. This is down right where we live, that we struggle with doubts and things. And I know you're not knocked off your throne because of my own humanly frustrations and doubts and worries and fears. Lord, but help me get on that pathway where I could expose them. Help me lock that door back up. The enemy can't, let him who stole steal no more. That he's got to work at it because I've got protections in place that are through you, that I'm not destroyed for lack of knowledge because I know your word. I know what you got for me and what you got in store for me. And we're going to praise you every day in Jesus' name. Amen.